Is it just me, or was that Gengar pose similar to the very famous Itachi pose? Yes, ladies and gentlemen, episode 11 of the new Pokemon series, titled Koharu, Yamper, and sometimes Gengar too, just dropped, and in this episode, Koharu will finally be the focus of this episode while a Gengar is infiltrating the Sakuragi lab. What's gonna happen? Well, let's find out. The episode begins with us at the Sakuragi household early in the morning. Koharu's alarm is trying to go off, and she turns it off while she's still trying to sleep. In order to get her up, her Yamper gets her brother to wake her up by saying that she's gonna be late for school, which she doesn't really care, she falls back asleep. Then, he calls their mother, and she wakes her up by telling Koharu that she won't have time to braid her hair. This freaks her out, and she gets up. After her mom helps her braid her hair, she goes down to the dining room where the family's about to have some breakfast, but before that, she has to feed her Yamper. And as she's feeding it, they talk about the fact that even though she's very cold to her Yamper, it seems to like her the most, followed by the mother, the brother, and then Professor Sakuragi himself. After they're done eating, the professor and Koharu head to the lab. In the back of the car, Yamper's trying to play with Koharu, but she just sets him down. I think this entire family dynamic is fantastic. Just in these little 3-minute sequence for the intro, we get to learn so much about Koharu and her family. Koharu is someone who really cares about her hair. Her Yamper likes her a lot, even though she's cold to it, even without her really knowing about it, because when they call her out on it, she's like, really, am I? Her mother is kind, and her brother is just her typical younger brother. Up to this point, we haven't really known her that much at all. All we know is that she's the professor's daughter, and that's something that she seems to despise, or I shouldn't say despise, just that it's something that she doesn't seem to care about much. That small intro brings us closer to her character. We then cut to the Go Park behind the Sakuragi Institute where Ash and Go are. They check in on their Pokemon and we get to see a couple of Pokemon interactions here. For example, Go thinks that Ash's Dragonite and his Stantler and Scyther might fight and tries to stop it, but Ash stops him, and from that we see Ash's Dragonite giving the two Pokemon a big ol' hug. On the other end, it looks like Go's Pokemon are fighting between themselves, especially his Talo, who seems to be attacking his 3 Wurmple. But, similar to the Dragonite thing, Ash and Go don't realize that Talo's helping them train so that they can evolve. And, as they're heading down to stop what they perceive as a fight, the 3 Wurmple begin to evolve. The reason that Go has 3 Wurmple is that he was hoping one of them would evolve into a Cascoon and one of them into a Silcoon so he could get both a Dusox and a Beautifly. But just as luck, as all of them evolve into a Cascoon. Even though he's a bit sad, he doesn't really mind. I've said this in previous episodes, and even in Sun and Moon, but I love when they show Pokemon interacting in the wild. I think it brings a great sense of depth to the Pokemon world. Like, in this case for example, if Talo was out in the wild, and these were wild Wurmples, it would probably be attacking a Wurmple in order to eat them. But, since Go caught both those Pokemon, they're no longer wild Pokemon. So, while the Talo looks like it's attacking, really, it's just helping the Wurmple evolve. I really like that. The difference shown between wild Pokemon and trainer Pokemon, and how a little capture can change the entire nature of Pokemon. I think that's fascinating. We go back to the lab where we see Renji, one of the professor's assistants, about to work on his computer when the power goes out. He goes down to the basement to fix it when we see something spooky in the mirror. He calls out his Magnemite to fix the electricity when the Gengar comes from behind to spook him. He then notices the Gengar and tries to have his Magnemite paralyze it with Thunder Wave. But the Gengar has it tangled up in wires so it can't use it, and then the Gengar attacks him. I know it's cliche, but I like the little mirror spook thing. The introduction to Gengar here is really well done, and I like the fact that the assistant immediately recognizes that it is a Gengar. It seems like in a lot of episodes, things go flying around and for some reason, trainers who like live in a world full of ghost Pokemon can never figure out that it's probably a ghost Pokemon messing with them by having things float. I'm glad it wasn't the case here. We then cut back to the front of the lab where Koharu is about to head to school when all of a sudden, both Ash and Go race to the professor. Go tells the professor about his evolved Pokemon and asks Koharu if she wants to meet it, along with Ash's Dragonite, but she says that she has to go to school and leaves as Kakuna, the other lab assistant, comes to the lab. As she's leaving, Ash asks Go, does Koharu not like Pokemon? And he tells her something really interesting. He says, she used to, but now she's acting cold towards them. different people interact with Pokemon differently. And while I don't mind that second sentiment at all, I mean, think about it. We have cats, dogs, cows, whatever, wild Pokemon that have been domesticated in our world. Not everyone likes them. Similarly, in the Pokemon world, not everyone has to like Pokemon. It's a fine feeling to have. Of course, this is the anime, so they're never gonna have someone like that let that stand, but honestly, I think it would make for a wonderful contrast in the cast. Garu doesn't have to like Pokemon, she could just be indifferent to them, and that's fine. The more interesting part to me about this conversation, though, is that Go saying that Koharu used to like Pokemon, but she doesn't now. Anyways, as the professors are heading to the lab, they notice that the lab is dark, and they get spooked by Renji's Magmite, who's behind them, covered in wires. It leads them down to the basement, where they find Renji passed out before noticing the Gengar. The Gengar then heads up the stairs, where Yamper hits it with a tackle. What? Then, Ash's Pikachu battles it, sending its Shadow Ball flying before hitting it with a Thunderbolt. Listen, I know the anime's different from the game, but how the heck did Yamper hit the Gengar? That really took me out of this battle, which, besides that little mistake, is a small but pretty nice battle. The music is intense, and so is the action, because while Ash is taking on the Gengar, they have Yamper barking in the background, making a lot of noise, things are flying around, Go, who looks terrified, and all of this, like I said, is complemented by the music, and it turns this from a regular battle into a pretty memorable one. Come on, Pokemon, type matchups should matter even in the anime for some parts. We then go back to Koharu School, where the teacher asks the class what their future dreams are. When it gets to her, Koharu doesn't really have an answer. Her classmates all assume that she's gonna follow in her father's footsteps and be a professor, but she doesn't even really seem to know her true feelings on Pokemon, whether she likes them or not. Then, when everyone is outside and Koharu is watering some flowers later, her mother shows up. She brought Koharu her lunch, and they sit down, and Koharu tells her about the class, and how she didn't appreciate her classmates trying to decide her future for her, since she doesn't even know what her future is. She asks her mother, did she always know what she wanted to be, an illustrator? And her mother tells her that, originally, she didn't want to be just an illustrator, she wanted to be a mangaka. But, even though she practiced a lot, she couldn't do well at it. And as she was about to give up, in a class with a young Professor Sakuragi, he told her not to quit since it looked like she was enjoying it so much. She's realized that even though she isn't a mangaka now, or even a particularly famous illustrator or anything, she's doing something that she enjoys, and she tells Koharu that there will be times when she'll have to make this decision, but she's 10 right now, she doesn't need to rush. I like this part a lot. I think this is something that all children can relate to, so I think that having this in this episode was a great choice. We also get to learn a bit more about Professor Sakuragi and how he met his wife, which is nice. And I think this portion of the conversation really works better for the long run, rather than this episode in particular. Because I think this is going to become a plot point, so that by the end of this series, we know what Koharu wants to be when she grows up. Back in the lab, Ash and Go are still looking for Gengar when Go says that they should try to see who can capture that thing first. And right as he says that, the Gengar reappears and he tries to capture it, but it just deflects the Pokeball back at him. There's also a bit here when they're chasing the Gengar and Mr. Mime's in the hallway. So in order to not spill the clothes, he throws the clothes up, uses Psychic, and then catches it afterwards. And then when Ash is like, nice job, he makes this very meme-like face. That's very creepy, but very well done. After catching up to the Gengar, though, they have another battle where Pikachu cuts a Shadow Ball in half. That's pretty intense. But then Yamper gets hit by Ice Punch and gets frozen, so Scorbunny has to unfreeze it. The Gengar then gets away when Pikachu blocks another Shadow Ball with an Electroweb. Similar to before, it's a pretty nice fight, and I don't think I've ever seen Iron Tail cut a Shadow Ball in half. That might be the first time I've seen that. Regardless, while Ash and Go are looking for the Gengar in the lab, Professor Sakuragi and his assistants are going to use the computer to check the temperature in the lab. Whenever one portion of the lab gets cold, that's when they know where the Gengar is going to be. As the search is happening, Koharu gets home and Yamper goes out to greet her. But it turns out the Gengar is hiding in the lobby by the entrance. Yamper gets hit by a Shadow Ball by Gengar, which was aimed at Koharu, so it did that to protect Koharu. And it's about to use a second Shadow Ball at Koharu when Ash and Go show up and Pikachu uses Thunderbolt to deflect it. Then the Gengar uses Psychic on Ash, Go, and their Pokemon to make them levitate so they can't attack, while the Yamper stands in front of Koharu and the professors see that. He tries to have Yamper use Spark on the Gengar, but it doesn't work because the Yamper is so focused on saving Koharu. He tells her that she needs to command it because it's only listening to her. She's super nervous at first since she's never battled before, but eventually, after Ash and Go cheer her on, she has the Yamper use Spark, sending the Gengar flying out of the lab. Afterwards, she hugs the Yamper. I know I didn't really say much during that entire sequence, but honestly, it's because there's nothing really much to comment on. It was your pretty standard battle fare until Koharu got there. So, this has happened a couple times in the anime, and each time it's annoyed me. It also annoyed me when Lily did this, so don't think that I'm being inconsistent or anything, but if you're in the Pokemon world, characters battle all the time. Why are characters so baffled when they have to battle? Like, Koharu just stands there forever after her dad tells her what she can do in that situation to make that situation better. Why? I know narratively it's because the characters are first-time battlers, so they're nervous, but honestly, it just makes them look so dumb when they're just standing there with their mouth wide open, not doing anything, when all of their friends need help. I don't know, that just bugs me. That's not just a Pokemon thing, by the way, that happens in a lot of anime, so I don't want to single out Pokemon here. And another thing, let us see the aftermath of that, particularly for Koharu. And I don't mean the aftermath as in showing Koharu later on in the sequence when she's in bed. I'm talking about right after she beats the Gengar, what happens? What does Ash say to her? What does Go say to her? What does the professor say to her? What do the lab assistants say to her? What does she say about her first battle? These are things I want to know because it's good time for character development, and I wish shows would take that opportunity after battles to do that. The episode ends with Koharu in bed thanking the Yamper and sleeping with the Yamper for protecting her, showing her that she's bonding more with her Pokemon as her parents watch. A bit creepy by her parents, but wholesome nonetheless. And we see that the Gengar is outside and it looks like it's gonna be back later. My biggest complaint about this episode is just the ending, especially the Koharu fight. It just felt super rushed. I do like the fact that it seems like the Gengar will be recurring. I actually think it might end up with Koharu capturing that thing. One thing in the episode that we discussed, and really I hope we get an explanation because I talked about this before, but Go saying Koharu used to love Pokemon. Why? What happened? Why did it happen? I don't think this is going to be a full-on Lily type, but I am interested to find out, and I'm interested to see when that happens. Other than that, this is an alright episode. You can check it out if you want to learn more about Koharu. Honestly, you should, because her character development is very strange, but I think very fascinating. I'm more excited, actually, for the next episode. What's in the next episode? Leon versus Lance. Is there anything else I need to say? Hype! But anyways, that's it for my review of episode 11 of the new Pokemon anime. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, like, share, subscribe, everything like that. Let me know in the comments, what did you think of this episode? You can also follow me on Twitter at TheRealPDGaming, and that's it. I'll talk to you guys later. Peace.